Hi, and welcome to the Animal Health Laboratory at the University of Guelph. We're sharing this video so you can see what it's like inside of a commercial laboratory and so that we can share some top tips for you to get the most out of your lab submissions. When samples leave the clinic, they look like they're in pristine shape. However, they don't always arrive that way. At our lab, samples arrive, as you can see, and they're unpacked by our team in specimen reception. Our staff enter the information into our computer system and send it up to the lab as soon as possible. The biggest slowdowns in getting your samples from the clinic to the lab bench comes from samples arriving broken or leaking and with submission forms missing, not filled out, or illegible. Some samples of that can be seen here. You can help by having your staff watch our How to Submit series for best practices using an electronic submission form and writing clearly and completely on all of your submissions. Then the samples are entered into the computer system and sent up to the lab section. You can see here our staff are sending our samples up via the dumbwaiter to the second floor. When the samples arrive on the top floor, they get to the bench and they go through a second phase where they're double checked for accuracy, and then they go on to testing after being checked in again. Here's where we branch off into separate areas and showcase a little of what goes on in each section of our lab and how you can get the most of the samples that are sent in. Again, if you're wondering how to package samples so they're processed quickly and arrive at the lab in tip-top shape, check out our YouTube channel on packaging and shipping tips. They're also really great training videos for staff. Let's move on to bacteriology. We're going to feature a few of the machines we rely on for samples. For aerobic samples, samples are plated using the isoplater, which is featured here. This handy machine makes plating lots of samples a snap and is a big advance in both accuracy and speed on loop plating that you might remember from your days at the lab bench. Here's how we process anaerobic cultures in the lab. Note the number of steps involved in keeping the samples anaerobic. Make sure when you're packaging your samples to put them in the correct gel and handle them very carefully so that your sample still has living bacteria in it when it arrives at the lab. After being plated, all samples get incubated for 24 hours before being checked again. Note that if you're sending in blood cultures, please let us know on the submission form if they've already been incubated so that we can process faster. After the samples have been incubated, they're identified using the MALDI-TOF. If your sample has grown a pure culture, one type of bacteria, we run it through the MALDI-TOF. The MALDI-TOF uses mass spectrophotometry to look at the bacterial culture, comparing it with our library of results and finding a match to identify the bacteria. We use the MALDI-TOF in lieu of lengthy tests such as gram-positive, gram-negative, and more. This machine has revolutionized bacterial culture and increased the speed with which we can give you a bacterial identification. You'll get an interim report as soon as we have an ID, growth, etc., but note that this will take a minimum of 24 hours from the time that this sample got to the lab. Timing will be extended if it's not a pure culture. The better the sampling technique and handling procedures, the better chance to get a pure culture. Mixed cultures will need to be replated and examined another 24 hours later. Antimicrobial sensitivity takes another 24 hours after identification. Let's talk a little bit about submitting as well. You may not realize it, but sharing where on the body the sample came from helps the staff plate the sample. There are multiple types of media to use on samples, so make sure that you tell us if it's a skin culture, ear, wound, aerobic or anaerobic sample, and what you might suspect. For example, Clostridium and Salmonella. The age of the animal also really matters, especially in neonatal diarrhea, so add that in too. There are a couple of good ways to send in urine for culture as well. If you intend to send for culture in cytology, we recommend splitting them into two sample containers. You can order the correct supplies from your lab or purchasing wholesaler. Here's how we look at antimicrobial susceptibility. Our computer system measures the amount of bacteria killed by the antibiotics and compares it to the international guidelines to determine if the samples are resistant, susceptible, or intermediate to specific antimicrobials. You'll note we always check manually to double check, but the system is a big step up from a manual eyeball check or a ruler. Let's move on to molecular techniques. Featured here are some of our high-throughput equipment to process ELISA testing. These machines allow us to process multiple runs or different types of tests in high numbers, which comes in handy to avoid batch testing and also during outbreaks. In virology, we use a lot of PCR to make identifications on the samples you send in. Sample submission is important here as well. PCR can be done on various substrates, swabs, fluid, or tissue. Please note that the best packaging and sampling technique for PCR is to use virus transport media. A regular bacteriology swab put in a red top tube is next best. For PCR, don't put that swab back in the bacteriology gel media. When we receive the samples, the next step is to get the DNA or RNA, in the case of RNA viruses, from the sample. This extraction, as well as the PCR reaction itself, have quality checks and controls to verify the results. If any of these fail, we have to repeat the testing. PCR has evolved a lot over the years too. The original PCR method was gel-based PCR, where the extracted sample was put in a thermocycler to amplify the DNA and RNA, and then put on a charged gel plate to read it. There were numerous steps. Currently, most PCRs are real-time PCRs where the amplified DNA-RNA is linked to a dye to read after each cycle and allows us to quantify exactly how much of the virus is present in the sample. Techniques such as regular whole genome sequencing are also now available to further characterize the viruses found. Now let's move on to the last section we'll be showing today, clinical pathology. Commercial laboratories have high-throughput machines that help us process large numbers of samples with a quick turnaround time, looking a lot different than the in-clinic machines you may be familiar with. This is the Immulite machine, which we use to process ACTH and other hormone samplers. Advia 120 and the Cobas biochemistry machines are other examples we're going to show later. We also do extensive quality assurance each day and have extra machines to ensure we don't have downtime. Clinics may have their own machines, and doing quality assurance is really important on these machines too. There are a couple of great ways to do this, including sending in paired samples, one done on your machine and one in a commercial lab, on a regular basis, or running quality assurance samples frequently. One quick tip to remember is with whole blood samples, to spin down your blood and send in serum in a separate tube. Additionally, you can increase the value of your hematology samples by creating a blood smear before submitting. Another tip is to not put cytology and hematology slides near formalin and histopathology slides. They can be fixed and rendered not useful. Send them in separate containers. This is our biochemistry machine, which we can do a large number of samples in a short amount of time, and looks a lot differently than a small in-clinic machine, but does the same job. An additional tip to note is that the cold chain is really important as well to make sure that things don't get too cold or too hot. Samples right next to a freezer pack can lead to hemolysis of EDTA blood. Wrap them separately when placing them near freezer packs. Thank you so much for joining our virtual lab tour and top tips for submitting samples. Following the tips provided really helps increase the value of diagnostic dollars spent to get answers for your patients. You can visit our YouTube channel as well for our training videos. Take care.